Good morning, class. Today we are going to be talking about copyright rules. Even if you don't know the rules, that's not an excuse. It's still against the law to copy someone else's work. So today we're going to talk about why it's so important to know these rules and how to apply them. So our objectives for today are that you will be able to define the vocabulary associated with copyright rules. There are some specific words that you need to know to understand to be able to really grasp what copyright rules are. Secondly, you will be able to demonstrate knowledge of copyright rules. It's important for you to know these so that you don't end up accidentally plagiarizing someone. Third, you will be able to explain the circumstances behind fair use. Fair use is very important in copyright, and you need to know all the information behind that. And finally, you will be able to describe the use of Creative Commons. We will get deeper into this as we continue the presentation. That's a pretty fun song, though many people think that Bruno Mars wrote it. It was actually written by a man named Mark Ronson. Mark Ronson, unfortunately, is facing legal battles with three different bands because of this mega hit, Uptown Funk. Three different bands are accusing him of wrongdoing, saying that he copied some of their music or some of their words. It will be years before all of these cases are settled or dismissed. Miley Cyrus is being sued by a man named Michael May for $300 million in damages for the song We Can't Stop. This is another case that's pending in court, but Cyrus obviously hopes it's going to be dismissed. Taylor Swift has been sued for her song Shake It Off, which the man Sean Hall and Nathan Butler said copied some of their lyrics. This case was luckily dismissed from court. Robert Plant and Jimmy Page, part of Led Zeppelin, are being accused of copyright infringement to the song Stairway to Heaven, which is like one of their most popular songs. Their accuser, Wolf, claims that the opening guitar riff to the song is similar to the song Taurus by the band Spirit, which he was in. The court ruled not guilty of copyright infringement in 2016. The case is currently in retrial. Now, imagine one day in the future, you are a very famous rapper. You drop an album and one of your songs is an instant hit. Awesome. It's played on the radio stations all across the country. However, you don't make any money until you sell that album or song. Your album or song is available for download, but people have to pay for it, right? Well, a criminal decides to put your song and album on a website for downloading for free. Even though you're a huge success, you do not receive money for your hard work. Yes, I did use the word criminal, and you will understand why by the end of today's lesson. So, what are some important topics to know? When talking about copyright, you need to know these words: copyright, plagiarism, intellectual property, fair use, patent, trademark, public domain, and like I said before, Creative Commons. If you know these words, it will help you understand copyright rules much better. So let's dive right in to the vocabulary. The first word is copyright, which is the legal right given to the person who created an original work. Once you create something, it is automatically protected by copyright. For example, you write a poem. Your poem is your intellectual property, and no one has the right to copy your work without your permission. Plagiarism is taking someone else's work and passing it off as your own. When you copy and paste for an assignment, you are plagiarizing the original work. If you reword the original work and do not give credit to the original work, author, or artist, you are plagiarizing. You may not think that that it's that big of a deal because no one is harmed, but you would be very wrong. Like the rapper example, people are harmed by you using their work and not giving them credit. Imagine you have an incurable disease. Your doctor is very progressive and forward-thinking. He or she reads a medical report on an amazing new cure for your disease. Only this report was plagiarized from other medical researchers' reports and not accurate since it wasn't original research. People are harmed by this every single day in a variety of ways. The next word is intellectual property. That's any product of human creativity that is protected under the law. This can include art, music, writing, inventions, and recordings. When you create something and it is in its final form, it's automatically protected. An idea or concept is not protected until it's on paper, which can include digital format as well as traditional paper. You own your intellectual property unless a company paid you to create it. That means if someone uses it, and they must give you credit. The main way credit is given is a citation of the source. If you're using large parts of someone's intellectual property, you must get permission from the owner. And finally, fair use. This allows you to use brief excerpts of others' intellectual property without seeking permission. We will cover this in depth when we talk about the rules of copyright. Let's keep going. A patent is a license issued by the government for an invention. This means that no one else can copy or produce your invention. In order for an invention to be patented, one must submit the invention or new technology to the patent office for approval. A patent is protected for a set number of years. After that time, anyone can produce and sell that invention. A trademark, which I'm sure you guys are familiar with, that little TM, is a word, name, or symbol that distinguishes a company. One example that you are probably familiar with is the Nike swoosh and the slogan, "Just Do It." Nike doesn't have a trademark with each of the words, of course, but the combination of those words and the symbol is indeed a trademark. A company that sells services instead of goods has a service mark, which is the same thing. Public domain. This is creative work that is not protected by copyright. Copyright is in effect for the creator's life plus 70 years. There are many examples of intellectual property that is now public domain, like the works of Shakespeare or the song Happy Birthday. Shakespeare has been dead for hundreds of years. For the birthday song that we will all sing, it has been involved in a legal battle and is now considered public domain. The company that claimed to own the copyright has to refund millions in usage fees. If it was protected, you would not be violating the law by singing at a family gathering, but you would be if the song appeared in a movie. And finally, Creative Commons. Free copyright licenses that authors can use so others know how they want their work to be shared. Sometimes authors will want their work to be shared so they don't have to keep giving permission over and over. Creative Commons licenses give them this ability. We will talk more about this at the end of the lecture. So let's take a look at a couple examples. Some examples of works that are protected by copyright are things like photographs, paintings, drawings, writing, music, dramatic works, architectural drawings, choreographic works, audiovisual works, and sound recordings. Examples of things that are not protected by copyright are ideas and concepts. So like we were saying before, if you have an idea, it's not copyrighted, but once you get it down on paper, whether in digital format or traditional, it becomes your intellectual property and it can be copywritten. Recipes and facts are not copyright protected. So you might be asking, so what, really? I can't use anything written by anyone? No, that's not the case at all. You can use parts of people's intellectual property that is copyrighted without asking permission, but only under certain circumstances. You have to give credit to the author, and your use of the work has to consider these four rules. One, the character or purpose of your use. If you're using the excerpt for educational purposes as opposed to commercial purposes, like trying to sell something with it, you often don't have to request permission, you just have to give credit. The nature of the copyright work. Using a research article to cite information for a presentation is considered fair use, but make sure you always give credit to the original author. Three, the amount of work that will be used. The amount of copyright work, it's important to remember general rules that determine the amount that you can use without permission. We're going to go into that a little bit deeper. Remember, you always have to give credit. And four, the effect that you using the work will have on the value of the work. If whatever you plan to do with the copyright work would have an effect on sales of that work, it's usually not under fair use. So you can't make money off of someone else's work. The most important point for you to understand is that the fair use, under fair use, is that you are able to use copyrighted text, but you still have to give the author credit. So how much can you use? We're going to talk about various examples of how much you can actually use, the rules behind copyright. First, for printed materials, poems, you can use less than 250 words. Or less than 1,000 words of text, or just 10% of what the text is. Or you can use two pages of illustrated work that is less than 2,000 words, one chart, picture, or illustration from a periodical. The rule is these can be used in a multimedia project.
So you're good to go.
In terms of photographs and illustrations, if you're using collections of photographs or the individual photographs or illustrations, there's two rules. One, when you're using a collection, you can use up to 10% or 15 images of that collection, with giving credit, of course, but without asking permission. Or if you are using individual photographs, you can use 5 images or less that can be used by a single photographer or illustrator. In reference to videos, talking about clips from the internet, DVDs, videotapes, QuickTime movies, the rule is that you can use 3 minutes or 10% of the media, or you can use portions of legally acquired media in academic projects. Now, music. We're talking about audio clips from the internet, CDs, records, cassette tapes. I'm sure you know everything about those last two on that list. The rule is when creating a multimedia project, only 10% is allowable. So, for example, when I used Mark Ronson's song at the beginning of this lecture, I only used a small portion of it. So, I'm going to make sure that I cite him at the end and that I only use 10% or less of his song. Computer software. That's either software that's purchased or software that is licensed, meaning that you like get a license to use it, but you're not actually purchasing it. The rules are that one, you can make one copy of it for backup purposes, archival purposes. So if you need that program, you don't want to lose it, you've got to back it up. You can have that one copy and you don't have to ask permission. Also, you can install onto another hard drive, or you can translate it if it's not in the desired language that you need. Now, the internet. Dun dun dun. Yes, the internet can be a little bit tricky. Images can be downloaded, but you have to give credit to the given author. If you can't find the copyright holder, you can't use it. So be really careful with that. Once again, in terms of like video and sound files, you can use 3 minutes. Or less, or 10% of the work. Now, copyright is something that can expire. I kind of alluded to that earlier, but there are some special rules about this too. For example, copyright expires 70 years after the author's death. That's why we can copy something from Shakespeare and it is okay because he's dead and he's been dead for a long time. It's also 100 years after the creation of a work is made for hire. So if someone hires you to make something 100 years down the road, it's not covered by copyright anymore. You won't be alive, but hey, whatever. Now, once again, works printed before January 1st, 1978 are protected for 20 years, but they can have their copyright renewed for another 75 years. Now, what happens if you want to use more than just 3 minutes of something, or 10%, or more than 250 words of a poem, or more than 1,000 words of a text? What do? You can still use it, but you have to get permission. When getting permission to use copyrighted work, you can ask the author, but oftentimes you're more successful if you contact the publisher of the product. When you are specific with what you're trying to use, there will be no confusion of which pieces of the work you're requesting permission to use. You'll most likely have to pay a fee to use someone's work, so it's important to let them know if you don't use that work after all, so that you don't have to pay the fee. Make sure that you keep any correspondence, so any mail that you have back and forth with these people, because copyright is a legal issue. You want to make sure that you are covered if there's some misunderstanding. If the author doesn't respond or says no, you cannot use their work. Don't think that, oh, they didn't respond, that means I can use it. Nope. Be careful to avoid copyright infringement. Now, like we talked about before, one of our words was Creative Commons. Creative Commons are licenses that are given when authors do not want to have to keep responding that someone can use their work. They want to share their work with the world and let people use it as long as they get credit. Imagine someone who is a photographer and they have this beautiful background that they want people to actually be able to use, but they want to make sure that their name is connected to it. There's varying degrees of licenses. Authors can give the use of all of their work, like a whole entire photograph, or they can use it only in certain circumstances. Creative Commons licenses are varying in degrees on how much they're going to share with people, but you can also use these. So there's a little bit of a difference between copyright infringement and plagiarism. Copyright infringement is a legal problem. Infringing on a copyright involves breaking a law. Defining what does and does not constitute infringement is the job of lawmakers. The consequences are determined and enforced by the legal sector. So going to court and being sued and having to go through that whole process is when you're talking about copyright infringement. For example, Taylor Swift and Mark Ronson, they're going through legal battles right now. Plagiarism, on the other hand, is an academic and ethical problem. That means that it has to do with your morals. Plagiarizing involves academic or professional dishonesty. So you're not being honest with your work, saying that you did something that someone else did. Defining what does and does not constitute plagiarism is the job of school administrators or a professional board of ethics. The consequences are determined and enforced by a school or other institution. This actually happened to me when I was in college. A classmate of mine copied my work that I had already posted to a public place, and she passed it off as her own. Luckily, she was caught, and she was forced to fail the class, which ended up making her not be able to continue with her degree. It's very serious stuff, so be careful trying not to plagiarize. So I would be remiss to not include my citations, my sources, for this information that I've given you. You can see on here, the second one is Mark Ronson. I have to give him credit because I used his song in my presentation. I used less than 10%, and I'm giving him credit. I'm covered. I am not copyright infringing him. I'm not using anything, passing it off as my own. I'm giving him that credit, and that's what you need to do too with your work. So I hope that you learned something today and that you are prepared to follow these rules.